informative lunch and learn about polypharmacy, the taking of four or more medications. Brought to you by the Clearview Regional Medical Center.
This is Paul Mullins with Walton Entertainment. I'm here at Stanley's Bait and Tackle Shop. And Stanley, looks like you've gotten a lot of pumpkins in.
Yeah, they come in yesterday morning about 10:30. We got 92 big pumpkins this year.
And that was Saturday the 26th, right?
26th, right. Yesterday
okay.
morning.
Got
92.
Pumpkins. Okay, and weight. How much? Some of these look like they weigh maybe 100 pounds. Yeah. Is that?
The smallest average is about 75 pounds, and they go up to about 150, 175 pounds on the big ones.
Okay, and I was talking to you earlier, and you've got some regular customers that come here and get a pumpkin, like people go out to get Christmas trees. Right. Is that correct?
Yeah, I've been doing this about 15 years now, and probably I've got people been coming the last 10 or 12 years every year buying the same pumpkins every year from me. Just like they get Christmas trees every year, they come here and buy the big pumpkins, and I've even watched the kids grow up now. They're bringing their kids, so it's been a big thing.
And you said that a lot of people just use these for decorations.
The decorations, they will not, they won't cut them like the jack-o'-lanterns. The ladies like to decorate with them for through Thanksgiving and the harvest season, and there's a few that will cut them if they got a bunch of, you know, grandkids, but most people decorate with them.
Okay, if you were to cut one, is it thicker than a regular pumpkin, about twice as thick, something like that?
These rinds are thicker than a regular pumpkin, and it takes a lot of more work and time to carve these out.
Okay, so you'd have a day's work to carve one into a jack-o'-lantern, right?
Several hours, a long time.
Okay, you said you got your shipment in Saturday.
Yeah.
About how long will these last?
It usually takes me about 2.5 weeks to sell all these big ones.
Is that right? Two and a half weeks.
But I continue going back and forth to the market and pick up the small stuff, you know, every week. But the big ones last about 2.5 weeks.
About 2.5 weeks.
Yeah.
So if somebody's out there is wanting one of these giant pumpkins, you need to react pretty fast, I would say. Come down and see you. What are your hours?
Right now we open 7 days a week from 8 o'clock in the morning to dark.
Oh, 8 o'clock to dark.
8
okay.
o'clock to dark. We got to move them out.
Okay.
And I've already got people calling want me to reserve them for them. So,
okay.
We got some already marked sold.
Well, I'm going to take a few shots. You can see a few of them around here. I'm going to show you. There are a lot of them here. So I'm going to get on the camera and take some shots of the jack-o'-lanterns. And Stanley, thank you so much.
Appreciate it. Y'all come down to see us. We'll be glad to sell you a big pumpkin.
Welcome. We're so glad you guys are here. I believe most of you guys know me, but I'm Emily Russell and I do the marketing here at Clearview Regional. We're just so pleased to have you guys with us. We love getting together on a monthly basis to talk about some sort of a health topic. And today we have a very special guest with us. I would say that she is perhaps our newest healthcare provider on the Clearview team, Ms. Tiffany Welch. And Tiffany is a certified physician's assistant. She has four fabulous children, and I've had the pleasure of meeting two of them. Be sure and ask her about her son. He is a child actor, so interesting story there, absolutely. So she's originally from Washington, D.C., but most recently moved to us from Tallahassee, and she graduated in Washington, D.C. from Howard University in 1999, and of course she was at the top of her class, so you know that you were in good hands. She's been practicing as a PA for a little over 15 years, and she's helped do different preceptorships with students and helping get students oriented to the medical world, and she loves just any time that she can get hands-on and help shape future generations for clinicians. And she started out specializing in obstetrics and gynecology, but she realized that she loved family medicine and community medicine, and that's actually what we've hired her to do with us here. She is helping us transition some of Dr. Mohan's patients from his recent retirement, and then in December, Tiffany is going to be transferring to help head up our new urgent care center that is going to be going into Loganville. starting probably December, January, kind of depending on how quickly that construction goes. So we are just so excited and blessed to have her on our team. She brings a wealth of knowledge and experience. And we're just so excited to have her, and I think that you guys will love getting to know her as well. And today what she's going to talk about is medication management. How many of you guys are on medications? How many people know how all of them interact with one another and what does what and what could be bad if they were mixed together and all that kind of stuff? It's just crazy, isn't it? Just crazy. So Tiffany is here to give us a layman's terms version of medication management. So I think that you guys are really going to enjoy her talk today. So without any further ado, I'm going to pass it over to you, Miss Tiffany.
All right. Well, again, like Emily stated earlier, I am so excited to be here with you guys this afternoon to just shed some light on what we call polypharmacy. And we'll get into what that word means a little bit later. But just by show of hands, how many of you see more than one physician? Yeah. How many see more than two? Okay, three? Anybody have three or more? Four? Four different physicians? Nope, okay. Wow, okay, you guys get the prize. So this talk is gonna be really important for you all, and I've also provided some take-home handouts for you to use at your leisure when you go into your next appointment with your physician. So let's start off. Feel free that I want this to be interactive, so don't hesitate to ask a question or interject a comment if you something comes up. So polypharmacy. Well, polypharmacy affects about one out of three, okay, persons over the age of 65. So that's a high statistic. The significance, it's a significant cause of death in the elderly, and in fact, some studies have shown that if polypharmacy was actually a disease, that it would probably be about the third or fourth leading cause of death in elderly patients. So that's quite significant. It's getting up there with heart disease. So I did want to do a disclaimer on the PowerPoint presentation. Actually, chiropractor by the name of Lisa Killinger provided this PowerPoint presentation, so we'd like to thank her for allowing us to use it. She did a great job on it. So the cost, let's talk a little bit about the cost of drugging, what we call drugging our seniors. So about 25% of all hospital admissions in the elderly are due to what? Drug reactions. So that's quite significant. Older persons may take an average of five prescription medications and are taking at least about three over the counter. So that's like including your vitamins, any topical creams that you might be taking, any herbal supplements. So how many of us are on some of those? Anybody take any vitamins? Take vitamins. And any over the counter meds, pain medicine, or otherwise, right? So all of those things can possibly potentially interact with your prescription. So just something to be mindful of. So again, according to the Healthy People 2010, is a health initiative that the government established to help with health promotion and managing, preventing disease processes. So it was a huge initiative. So they've since then modified that. But on this initiative, polypharmacy is the principal drug safety issue problem in the United States. So it's a pretty big deal, particularly in not just older persons, but mainly in older persons. Okay, so let's get to the definition. What is that big fancy word mean, polypharmacy? Well, bottom line, it means taking too many medications. All right, and we are in a pill population right now. Our society is headed in that direction. We have a pill for everything. And so sometimes those medications are needed, but other times we may be able to do some more conservative measures. So when you take two or more drugs, the chance of you having a negative interaction is about 5%, okay, already, just with two. So when you're taking five drugs, at least five drugs, the chance jumps up to 50% chance of having a negative interaction with your medication. So I'm sure with we had a few here who were seeing multiple physicians. I'm sure that you have to be at least on about five different medications. And then some people are even on eight or more. I think someone mentioned earlier that they know someone who's taking 17 different prescriptions every day. And so eight or more, your chance is nearly 100% that you will have some kind of negative interaction or outcome due to the medication alone. So let's use an example here. So part of polypharmacy is taking several different meds for the side effect of your other meds. Anybody had to do that before? Like you're taking one medication, but that medication causes a side effect, so then you gotta get another medicine to help with the side effect that you're experiencing with the first pill. So here's an example. Let's talk about Esther. She's taking acetaminophen, which is Tylenol, and codeine for her arthritis. Due to the constipation that the codeine caused, she now has to take additional meds to help treat her constipation. So she needs two laxatives for that. So her medications went from two to four, just like that. So that's a form of polypharmacy. Also, another form of polypharmacy is taking meds or drugs that have negative interactions or dangerous side effects when they're combined with each other. Okay, so this is why we were talking a little bit earlier about the brown bag method. Anybody know what remember the brown bag method? So the brown bag method is when you take all your medications, you get a brown paper bag, and you dump them all in there, everything that you're taking, and keep them in their bottles, their right prescription bottles. Take all the prescription bottles, throw them in the bag. Any topical creams that you're using, throw those in the bag as well. Any vitamins or herbal supplements, anything that you're consuming or putting on your skin, throw it all in the bag and carry it with you to your doctor's appointment. Okay? And I'll tell you why. Because a lot of times people don't realize that some over-the-counter medications can have just as many side effects as prescription meds. Mm-hmm. Or they can interact with something that you're taking from your doctor. But if we don't know everything that you're putting in your mouth, it's very difficult for us to help you and kind of circumvent that problem. So I love the brown bag. Come in with the brown bag. It takes time, yes, to go through it, maybe 20 bottles or so, but that's okay. And don't be afraid to do that with your physician. Okay, sometimes we're trying to, out of respect, we don't want to take up a lot of the doctor's time, but medical treatment is a team approach, and I want you guys to know that you're a vital part of the team, right? It's your body and it's your healthcare. We want to, in order to do our job the best we can, we need you to really participate. And so bring your brown bags. And so we got Iris. So Iris, she likes to have a little nightcap. Now, I'm not sure all what's in her nightcap, but she has a nightcap or two every night before she goes to bed to help her sleep. And she's also taking NSAIDs, which that can be, NSAIDs are like your ibuprofen or Aleve, Motrin, anything like that. Those are considered NSAIDs. And she takes that for her back pain. And she's also on blood pressure medication. And she ends up extremely hypotensive. That means her blood pressure end up bottoming out. And she also developed a stomach ulcer due to the bad drug combination that this caused. But she didn't think anything was wrong with mixing her pain medicine with the nightcap that on top of her blood pressure medicine. So that could have potentially been a really bad situation. Any questions so far? How many of you use more than one pharmacy? Does anybody use? That's great. It's good to, another point I wanted to interject is that Using one pharmacy has been shown to cut down on the risk of polypharmacy. So, because if you're using more, like say you go get your blood pressure medication at one pharmacy, but you get your pain pills from another pharmacy, well, those pharmacies don't necessarily communicate with each other. So they may be thinking you're just on their med list that they have, when in fact you have a whole nother med list over here, and that could cause a potential problem. So again, we talked about taking medications prescribed by several different providers. So again, the same with as it is with the pharmacies, if you have more than one physician, don't assume that these physicians are communicating well with each other, especially if you see a specialist. Most of the times we do get those records from the specialist, but not always all those medication lists merge together. So again, this is where you guys come in, and you can, if you happen to see your medication specialist on Thursday, but you have an upcoming appointment, you know, on Friday with your primary care provider, and that specialist changed some medications up, please bring that bottle if you have it, or if not, I'm going to give you some a sheet that you can write down your keep up with your medications with. Write it on that sheet and bring it to that appointment with you so that they can put it in their system as well. So most of the time we do communicate with each other, but not always. So don't, it's just safer not to assume that we know anything about what the specialist is giving you, okay? So Wilma had a situation like this. She was taking her antihypertension meds or blood pressure meds, and also taking some ibuprofen for her arthritis, but she had an appointment with the dentist. Right? So the dentist also gave her a narcotic pain medicine. So narcotics are like those control substances. They interact with a lot of different things. So she didn't think she was doing anything wrong by taking the medication that she usually takes and then the narcotic with it. So she also sees a psychiatrist for her depression. And the psychiatrist prescribed her amitriptyline. Now, amitriptyline is a wonderful drug, but it also has quite a bit of side effects, and it interacts with a whole lot of different things. So there's a lot of risk in this scenario right here, but and we'll get to that in a second. So some common drug side effects are in aging patients. The list is right here. But I just wanted to say that some of these common side effects, like dizziness, for example, well, there are a ton of things that can cause dizziness besides just medications. Dehydration can cause dizziness. If your blood pressure gets too high or too low, that can cause dizziness as well. Or cardiac, any type of heart conditions can cause dizziness as well. Well, so can a lot of these medications that we talked about. So sometimes it can be hard for the doctor to know if the dizziness is coming from your condition, your health condition, or is it coming from the prescription that we gave you. So anytime you notice a new symptom, right? If you notice a new symptom that every time I take this particular pill, this blue pill, I start feeling dizzy shortly after. Don't just, you know, shrug it off like, maybe I just need time to get used to the medicine, you know, whatever. I won't bother the doctor with that bit of information. That's important information that we need to know to manage your care. Like, well, I don't, you know, you can just present it to the doctor like, well, I don't know if it's the medicine or not, but I notice that every time I take this blue pill, I get dizzy. And we'll investigate it further because it could be your health condition or it could be the medication that we need to take you off of or lower the dose. Okay. So there's several reasons why elderly patients, we'll just say anybody over 65, are at risk for drug toxicity or bad reactions. And Some things kind of happen to the body with the aging process. You know, the organs don't always function as well as they did when you were in your when we were in our 20s. So part of the aging process, you have increased storage in the fatty tissues, and instead of it being in the lean body mass, because as we get older, we kind of lose some of that lean body mass. And that lean body mass is very important in drug absorption. So we have less of it when we get older, so the drugs sometimes just sit in your system longer, and that we don't want that to happen because, you know, for example, if we give you a 10 milligram pill, that you used to take that same 10 milligram pill when you were in your 20s and you did fine on it, but now all of a sudden that 10 milligrams may be too strong and your blood pressure is going lower and lower and lower. Well, this may be why. Also, the way you process food and digestion can be a little bit slower. You lose some of that motility to move food and medicine through your system as we get older. So that's an important thing to be mindful of. So, and then you have decreased blood flow to the organs, and you know, things just kind of start slowing down. You have less water in your body, so it's important to keep hydrated so we can keep the flow going. So, you know, the thing I like to be mindful of as a clinician is that to go slow and low with persons over 65. I can always increase your medication, but it's hard to, if I give you something too strong initially, one, to convince you to take it again, and two, to go backtrack and pull the medication back. So it's better to go slow and low. We start you off with a little bit at a time, see how you do for that couple of weeks, and then if it's not strong enough to get your blood pressure down or your sugar down, then we can bump it up just a little bit. So don't be afraid to ask your provider, hey, I know you want to start me on this new medication to get my diabetes under control or what have you, but is it all right if we kind of go slow and work our way up? But that's a safer way to go. Okay, there are some medications that, that we were talking about the Healthy Persons Initiative. There's also a study that went out, and it came from what's called the Beers, like beer you drink, Beers criteria, where they investigated a ton of medications, and some of these medications were deemed inappropriate for people to take who are over 65 because of the side effects that they cause. And on that list are what we call benzodiazepines. They're slow acting. That's like your Xanax, your Valium, if anybody's on any of that stuff to help with anxiety. These medications need to be low dose if you're using them, and just use them as needed, sporadically. Because I have a list here of all the side effects I went through and did my research on these benzodiazepines. And it says, you know, if you have COPD, which is a lung condition, or if you have sleep apnea, which a lot of us do, any renal or liver disease, glaucoma, you don't think about eye conditions, we were talking about eye conditions, or an impaired gag reflex, you should not probably be using this medication. And gag reflex is like if you can touch the back of your throat without choking or doing that, one of those numbers, you have an impaired gag reflex. So what happens though, when you take these medications, it can slow down breathing and those kind of things. So that's why they don't want you taking it if you have any of those conditions. But also the thing with this benzodiazepine is that if you stop it, if you've been on it for years and years and you stop it all of a sudden, it could put you at risk for seizures. So again, there needs to be a continued dialogue between the medical provider and the patient about what they're doing. So this one, you would have to, again, taper off of it kind of slow. Not just say, you know, Tiffany told me that if I'm on this med, I probably shouldn't take it. I'm stopping it. Don't do that. Discuss it with your, take it into your brown bag and take it to your provider and discuss it with them. Yes,
ma'am. I would just like to say, be sure you read the side effects on your prescriptions too.
Good.
Because I have high blood pressure real bad, and the doctor prescribed me 2 medications that I was not supposed to take. And when I asked him about it, he said, well, Medicare won't pay for that other. It would have cost you $80 to get the one you want. I said, well, should I spend $80 and get something I can use, or $26 and get something I can't use?
See, that's a very good example of polypharmacy, because you remind me of another a patient I had who, she was new to our practice, and she had been seeing several different other doctors, and she was pretty good. She brought everything in with her, but once we reviewed all these different medicines from the other, the specialists and us, and this, she was on 4 times the dose of blood pressure medication that she should have been taking. Because every drug has 2 names. It has the drug name, and then it has the generic name. And so, sometimes it's hard for us as providers to keep up with what name is what for the drug. So you could be taking 2 of the same medication. One could be actually the brand name, you know, like that the insurance doesn't usually want to cover, and then the generic, and not realize it. So that could have been a very bad situation. But fortunately, we took the time to sit down and review everything that she was on and get it corrected. But yeah, you raise a good point. So for time's sake, I won't go through all these other medication. Just know that, okay, like for example, this phenylbutazone, it's a safer choice, it's less toxic, but that is not available in the U.S., so it's not any worth discussing. So, but there are usually some safer alternatives that we can do. Some of those safer alternatives, you know, may not control your pain as well, but puts you at risk, less risk. And so that's just something to be mindful of. And I'm going to skip over this one, actually. So we talked a lot about, we kind of talked bad about a lot of drugs. But so are drugs always bad?
No.
No, a lot of times, most of the medications you're on could be life-saving, in fact. And a lot of studies have gone out in these FDA-approved medications that show that if you take it, you're okay?
Yeah.
You're okay. That it could cause longevity of life. So now I don't want to give drugs a bad name. They have their place. But sometimes we're on too many. Okay? And we should consider natural methods again. We should consider some natural methods first. So, least invasive to most invasive. But again, a chiropractor put this together. She has a strong passion for least invasive to, and in fact, chiropractic care is not just, people think of a chiropractor as just back pain. If you go see them if you have back pain. But they treat a whole host of other disease processes. Even some chiropractors can help you with gastric or upset stomach issues and migraines and those kind of things. So you may want to talk to you. I'm pregnant. Okay, so how can we help? We already talked a little bit about how you can be a team player with us with the brown bag situation. Also, using one pharmacy. We kind of went over that. So make sure you only use one pharmacy. I think most of you guys are doing that, so that's great. And communicate with your provider. Sometimes that's the piece that's lacking. You know, you guys come from a very respectful generation, and that's not a bad thing. But at sometimes that can cause a little timidity when it comes to talking to your doctors out of respect. You may not ask all the questions that you want to ask. So if you're a little bit camera shy with that, just write out your concerns on a piece of paper before you come to that appointment and just slide it to tell the nurse to give it to the doctor. I have some concerns that I wanted to discuss with Dr. So-and-so today. So if he has time, we could go over those. That would be great. But don't be afraid to communicate with us because we're here for you. And we want to do provide you with the best health care that we can. But in order to do that, it's like a relationship. It takes communication, right? Is that right for the couple who's been married over 60 years?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep. Communication. All right, we're almost done here, but I wanted to talk about side effects a little bit. If you have questions about, because certain medications, if you don't take it with food, they won't work or metabolize the right way. And some medications you have to take on an empty stomach, like thyroid medicine, that has to be first thing in the morning before anything else, right? In order for it to work. So if you have questions about that, it's good to ask that question. Should I eat with this? You're prescribing this new medication for me, doc. Should I eat with this or not? And then if you notice you're on a particular medication and you start losing weight or gaining weight, that's something you need to mention to the provider as well, because that could be a potential, the medication letting us know that we may need to put you on something else. Again, don't forget to discuss the supplements and the herbs, the over-the-counter stuff that you're on with your doctor, too, to make sure it's okay to take that ginkgo biloba or, some people take St. John's wort, all those kind of different herbs you need to discuss with the provider. If you drink alcohol or using any, recreational drugs, that's also important because those also carry side effects with medication. So if you'd like to have an occasional drink from time to time, then you want to mention that just to make sure it won't interact with your medication. Also, if you're a diabetic and you tend to skip meals, you don't have the typical 3 meals a day type thing situation, then you want to mention that to the doctor because we may need to adjust your insulin based on that. Like if you're not a big breakfast person and you tend to not eat breakfast, then we need to know about it because that may change the way we prescribe the medication for you. And somebody mentioned labels, but that was a key point. Like labels, read your labels. If you can't read it or get scratched off or whatever, where you can't read it very well, you need to mention that to the pharmacist. Great, nobody here does that. That's good. I have had some patients who do that, and it's very concerning. Because not only do they not have the label available to tell them, remind them, some are 2 times a day, some are 4 times a day, some are first thing in the morning, some are before bed. So if you're not having your labels there, you're not really sure that you're taking it the right way. And we can also now, with technology, print out the purpose of that pill. So we can put on there for blood pressure, for cholesterol. So you'll know what am I taking this for? So labels are really important. And again, reading potential side effects, is very important. A lot of times they'll print on the side of the bottle, don't take with alcohol, or don't use if you're going to be in exposed sunlight for too long. All those things are important.
Hey, I'm Joey Sulkowski, head football coach at Monroe Area High School. Checking back in with you here a couple days after a big win for us on Friday night. Our first Region 8 Quad A matchup was with Madison County in a rain-soaked game that we played in the Purple Pit. Came out victorious, 49-32 over Madison County. We had a great, just all-around team game. Offensively, we were led by senior C.J. Winding, who plays running back for us. C.J. had 20 carries for 255 yards and 5 touchdowns, so just an unbelievable game for him. Offensively speaking, we rushed the ball 42 times for 478 yards, so just an unbelievable output for us and a torrential downpour, and then finishing up with a 100 yards passing as well to finish up with 578 yards of total offense. Our defense played very, very well. A lot of the points that Madison scored came late in the game. We had some reserves in the game, some younger players that we were getting some extra time in. So a couple of those scores came later, and so we were very, very pleased with how we played, and were paced really up front by our defensive line. They played really, really well against a pretty good Madison County offense that runs the wing tee and does some pretty good things. So we were very, very fortunate to come out with a win and to start 1-0 in the region. Big game coming up this upcoming Friday. We make the trip all the way up to Toccoa to play Stevens County. And Stevens is, you know, a team that finished second in the region last year, went on and did fairly well in the playoffs. Currently, they have the number one offensive lineman in the state, a guy that's a national prospect that's currently, he's already committed to play at University of Georgia next year. So, you know, we have our work cut out for us. Last year's game against Stevens County, we started slow. They were up 35-7 at the half. And then we came back in the second half and made it a pretty good ball game, but ended up losing that game ultimately 42-35. So we're excited. Hopefully we can do some good things against them this upcoming week and you know, and look to keep our streak going and get to 2-0 in the region and just one step closer to making the playoffs this year and having an all-around better year. So we're just very, very fortunate that this past Friday went as well as it did, and looking forward to some more added success in the coming weeks. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Amy Honeywell with the Partnership for Families, Children, and Youth, and I'm here with my spider friends to remind you about our annual Haunted House of Addictions. This year, we are going to be over at Loganville Middle School, the old Loganville Middle School, located at 152 Clark McCullers Road. We're going to be there October 16th, 17th, 23rd, 24th, and 30th, from 7 to 10 each night. Come out and join the Youth Advocacy Board as we learn, as we celebrate healthy choices and healthy lives all month long in October, but especially during our Haunted House of Addictions. We'll have over 50 volunteers coming out to haunt our house. And of course, our Demon of Addiction will be there yet again. We're changing it up this year. You'll see a lot of new things going on at the Haunted House, as well as our new location. We'll have new storylines. We'll have some more spiders, and we will definitely have ghouls and different addiction showing themselves throughout the Haunted House this year. We will be talking a lot about recovery and hope for people who have who live in addiction or have experienced addiction, but we definitely want to talk about how to prevent addiction, and that is what our whole Haunted House is about. So we hope that you come and join us 7 to 10 each night. It's $3 for children or students, and it's $5 for adults to come on out. If you want to learn more about the Haunted House or maybe how you can volunteer, we're accepting teen volunteers and adult volunteers this year. Visit our website. It's www.waltonyouthcan.org. You can also visit the portion that says Paint Walton Red as well, and that will give you information about how to volunteer and just even more information about the Haunted House itself. So we look forward to having you at our annual Haunted House of Addictions. We hope to see you there. Bye.
Hello, I'm Kenny Sargent with Keep Walton Beautiful in the Walton County Recycling Center. I want to thank you all for tuning in today. Here at the center, we're getting ready for our Rivers Alive events. The main thing we're doing, that's coming up on October the 10th, and we're excited about that. We feel like we have more volunteers this year, and this event just continues to grow and grow, and we're so excited about the youth that have shown so much interest and get out and put in such a big hand in cleaning up our waterways or areas close to waterways. So we're excited about that. We're getting together all of our supplies. We're going to be getting them out to the group leaders and things like that. And we're going to be good to go on October the 10th. The one thing we finalized the date and are starting to make arrangements for America Recycles Day. That's going to be on November the 14th. We'll have it here at the Recycling Center. We're going to close the scale for garbage again this year. So we want to get that message out there. We're going to make it all about recycling that day. And that is the best way to do it. We're going to do a document destruction. We're going to do the paint recycling like we've done the last couple years. We're also going to do a shoebox recycling. We'll come up with all the details and pricing and stuff like that as we go forward and get that information. But did want to go ahead and put out there that that date has been finalized, and we're looking forward to that. We want to offer a few more things for the citizens this year, and we're going to see how it goes, and hopefully we can continue to grow it. It is a day that we feel is very important, and it's a great platform for us to talk to the citizens about the importance of recycling and good environmental stewardship. And so I wanted to get that out there to you guys, and just so you would know, we'll come out with more details as we move forward, but for you to go ahead and kind of save that date, and we'll be looking forward to seeing you. Here at the Recycling Center, things are holding steady. We're staying busy, and everything is really going great here. Like I say every week, if you haven't been out to see us, come out here and let us show you what we offer to all the county residents in the way of recycling, and also trash disposal. We can show you what we offer on that side of things as well. But come on out, let us show you around and talk to you a little bit about what we do. And again, thank you guys for tuning in. We'll see you next time.
Freddie Johnson, I'm here to do the Recreation Report. Today I have Joey Logan here with me, and he is our newest member of the Recreation team. And one of his tasks is to come in and work with our soccer program, youth, and hopefully to start up some things with the adults as well. So, thanks, Joey, for coming on today, and tell us a little bit about the soccer program. I know it's somewhat, you're in your infancy stage, been here a little over a month, and but you've hit the ground with your feet running and got our soccer program headed in the right direction. So tell us a little bit about the soccer program.
Yeah, Jody, we're doing really well. I have currently 217 kids signed up right now, three select teams, several big age groups this year. Looking forward to starting my big project, which is winter futsal, coming up this winter. That's going to be a huge thing. I think it's going to be a big hit with our program.
So futsal, tell us, what is futsal?
Futsal is essentially small-sided soccer. It's indoor soccer. It's going to take place in the Nowell Gym. It's going to be basically the same outline as a basketball court. Built-up goals. It's going to be nice inside and the air conditioning. It's going to be a nice league for us.
Or heat, however, whatever the weather is in this wintertime. That's a good idea. And you play with what type of ball? Because it's in a basketball gym.
Well, you play with a futsal ball. It's still a size 5. It's a little bit smaller compared to a regular regulation size soccer ball. It's about a size 4.
Okay, and it doesn't bounce, sir?
No, sir. Just hits the ground and kind of dies. The extra padding on there helps that, so not really going to break anything or fly too far.
Well, that's great. Tell us a little bit about the youth side soccer. You know, we have 217 kids, and you usually range anywhere from around 300, 400 kids in the come springtime. What are some of the highlights of our youth soccer program?
Well, youth soccer program is growing. Really looking forward to next season as well. We're building up our program again and getting kids excited about playing for Walton County and not going elsewhere.
Okay. And I know there's different levels of soccer, whether it's rec level or premier level, and what's the differences in those?
The difference between recreation and select is essentially just the competition that you're playing. Recreational is more, you know, getting skills down, having a lot of fun. Select is more competitive. You're playing for wins and losses. You're playing for trophies. That's basically the differences between the two leagues.
Well, I know we certainly are going in the right direction, and one of the things we're always in need of, well, two of the things we're always in need of is volunteer coaches, and we have a pretty good training program for that as well. How would someone get involved in coaching, and what type of training opportunities are there?
Anybody who'd like to volunteer, I'd encourage, if you have a son or daughter, please, you know, coach them too as well. Stay on with them through as many years as you can. The more you develop your kid yourself, the more you get to develop a team too as well. Our training program is going to be probably revisited. It's very detailed and very organized, but also very fun and relaxed as well.
And the second thing that I know is in need of across the state and across the nation is for soccer officials. And that's a good opportunity for most young kids to learn the skills at a young age, because that the soccer is one sport that we do have and do allow younger kids. I believe you have to be how much older than the league you're participating in?
Depends on your certification, really, the level. But I think the earliest you can start refereeing is 11 or 12. So you can start doing U8 games. I believe it's 4 to 5 years of age. Going up from there, it also depends on competition level too as well. But for the most part, 4 or 5 years older than the oldest age group is what you can be refereeing.
Yeah, which is great. Most of our other sports, our baseball and softball and football, usually we have 18 and older. For our working officials, and they get paid very well to do that. It's a great, it's great to learn how to be a soccer official. And when you do go off to college or go back and you're in your hometown, you can always find a secondary job. So it's a good thing to learn how to do. Well, we appreciate you coming in talking about our soccer program. We'll have you on here periodically to keep us updated on how our soccer program is doing. I will let the viewers know we are registering for our basketball, which is our winter sports programs. Right now, we're registering, so if, by the time this is viewed, you probably have missed basketball registration, but go by our office, call, and see if we still have any spots available. Once registration ends, then we'll fill as needed into our program. Last year, we had over 1,000 kids playing youth basketball, so we had a ton of kids that wanted to play, and registration as of now is looking really, really well. It looks like we may even go further than the 1,000 that we had last year. Also, we invite you to come to our community centers. They're still open usually from 6 in the morning until 8 at night, with the exceptions of Wednesday and Saturday. They're abbreviated times, and then, of course, we're closed on Sunday. But get in. It's a great value. It's a great place to work out. It's a nice, clean, family place to come and work out. Stay healthy, and we invite you to come do that. Come and visit some of our community centers here at Felker Park and at Meridian Park. So, again, thanks a lot, Joey, for coming and being our guest on the show this week. And until next time, and remember, sportsmanship starts at home.
Hello, Walton County. This is Kevin Little with the Chairman's Report on Channel 16, Walton Entertainment. Today, I was going to talk to you a little bit more about transportation in the county. I think last time I touched briefly on transportation, but I talked a little bit about the reservoir and I talked a little bit about some splash projects that we had going on. A big deal that we got in Walton County is traffic. And you know, there's a lot of traffic backups and a lot more cars than used to be here. As I've said for several years now, we've still got 1970 roads and we got 2015 population and cars. But we got a little bit of good news over the last few weeks since I've talked to you last, and I may have touched briefly last time, but Charlotte Rowell Boulevard here on that runs from Highway 11 down to 138, we have let that to contract. E.R. Snell will be, as you come down Charlotte Rowell and you go under the bridge and just go past the guardrail just before you get to Walmart, they'll be starting right there with an additional lane. And that lane will run all the way out across the intersection at Spring Street and 138, and it'll go on out and terminate somewhere in front of Tractor Supply just past the Michael Etchison intersection there. And that should be able to carry the truck traffic and carry anybody else through that intersection, and hope that will alleviate the backups, which is coming out now when you're out on 278 Highway and you go down and you're making that left turn, because of the long stretch there through the signal. So they're allowing as many vehicles through the signalization there as can. And so that's good news, and we're excited about that. Also, we just learned some other traffic problems. If you're in Social Circle, Hightower, and in front of the school, the new high school down in Social Circle, DOT is going to help us fund a roundabout there, and the roundabout will be somewhere in the neighborhood of the library right at that intersection. We're working right now with Mayor Hal Daly and the City Council and the school board. Probably be a project that'll be done later this year when school's out for the summer. That is something that we're looking at, but DOT has graciously offered us a good bit of money to paying a good portion of that to help that happen. And so that's very important. Also on State Route 81 north of Walnut Grove, 81 is a very heavily traveled two-lane road on the western side of the county. And at Corn Dogs, DOT is gonna give us $400,000 contract for about $1 million project there to put a center turn lane at Guthrie Cemetery. Guthrie Cemetery runs out to the Walnut Grove High School, and plus there's just a lot of congestion in that area. Daryl McWaters, who owns Corn Dogs, is going to be working with us and possibly moving the entrance from Corn Dogs down to the area right across from Guthrie Cemetery, and that is also going to be a potentially proposed site for a future fire station there. So a lot of good things are happening there. We've also asked DOT to evaluate Rock Road and Bay Creek Road for signalization. The new middle school, Loganville Middle School, and the future K-5 Loganville Elementary School on Bay Creek Road between 78 and State Route 81. And they are going to be doing an evaluation there for a signal, and hopefully that will relieve some congestion. Then Rock Road, if you go down about a mile and turn to the right, Rock Road runs into Gwinnett County, and that's a pretty good backup there, so they're going to evaluate that one as well. Another thing that I want to talk about is Georgia DOT is really been promoting the Drive Alert and Arrive Alive. In the first 6 months of 2015, Georgia averaged 100 deaths a month on our roads, a significant increase over last year. These numbers mean Georgia's on a pace to see the first increase in traffic-related deaths in 9 years. We must turn this tide now. So what Georgia DOT and something Walton County will be participating in is the Georgia DOT Drive Alert and Arrive Alive. I want to challenge each one of you to put the phone down while you're driving just for one day and just see the difference. And then I also want to take you to challenge to ride up 78 Highway in Monroe, from Monroe anywhere in the county, Monroe to Loganville or Monroe toward Athens, and I want you to count 10 cars. And of those 10 cars, I will guarantee you that 8 or more, they'll have their phone in their hand, they'll either be texting or looking at something when they're driving down the road. And if that person stops in front of them suddenly or a deer runs out, what happens? So we have got to drive alert, folks. As many of you may or may not know that I come from traffic operations here in Walton County, and I worked in traffic operations for 7 years. So traffic fatalities, traffic accidents, and things like that are something that concerns me greatly, because of the fact that we can't drive the vehicle for you, and so we can't totally protect you that way. You have to protect yourself. We put as much signage as we can on the roads. We put as much striping out on the roads as we can. But I'm asking, one day a week, put your phone down and just see what a difference of you driving to and from where you're going. And then I also want you to look and see and count 10 cars and see if 8 people are holding their phones in their hands. Just look at that, and that right there will tell you that they're not driving alert. And so you'll know if somebody's got that in there. And the chances of an accident when you're not paying attention are extremely higher than if they're not. And I'm talking to you today on September the 16th, and we have had 2 or 3 fatalities in the last 2 weeks here in Walton County. And we've had 2 pedestrian fatalities. And it's extremely hard when you're riding down a 2-lane road to maneuver around just driving the car itself. But then if you have bicyclists, you have pedestrians, and then you're looking at your phone, and by the time you look up, you done hit something. So you have to be very careful and be extreme out there. Driving is a privilege, and we all need to take it very serious, because it's the future of how we move people around, and we need to try to cut down on people that's not driving alert. So Drive Alert, Arrive Alive, that's the motto we're going to have for the rest of this year and probably most of next year, and I'll be talking to you this again. If you have any questions or concerns, please give me a call, 770-267-1301. Thank you.
Hey, thanks for tuning in today. As normal, we're going to show you some of the dogs and cats that are here at the Walton County Animal Shelter. But first, just want to give you a few words about some upcoming events and things. This here, a beautiful looking bulldog, pit bull mix. We get a lot of these dogs into the shelter, and because the reputations that pit bulls have, they're really hard for us to get them out into rescue and people adopting them. So really, there's no need at all to breed your pit bulls. And so thanks to Paradox Spay Neuter Clinic and Pound Puppies and Kittens, they have a program that runs here in Walton County called Fixable. They'll do free spays for pit bulls for Walton County residents. So maybe you have a pit bull and don't take a chance on an accidental breeding, because if you can't find homes for the puppies and they come here, we have really such a hard time getting those adopted out and into rescue just because the reputations that they have. Might be kind of unfounded. These are usually sweet dogs, but nevertheless, that reputation is there. So you can look on Paradox Spay Neuter's website about that fixable program. That program is done as a donation by Paradox and Pound Puppies and Kittens, and it's supported through their vaccine clinics. And so I wanted to tell you about an upcoming vaccine clinic which goes to support these free spays and neuters for pit bulls. It's going to be on Saturday, September 26th, and it's at Paradox Spay Neuter Clinic, which is near Walnut Grove High School. Rabies shots, get this, are only $15. Distemper shots, $15. And you can even get microchipping for just $25. So really cheap to get your dog current on the vaccine, and that money goes towards getting girls like this spayed for free in Walton County. So don't breed your pit bulls. Go ahead and get them spayed, especially if you can get it done for free. And now we're going to show you some of the dogs and cats here at the shelter.
Speck, she's a Chihuahua mix, about 1 to 2 years old. She's already been tested for heartworm. She's negative, and she's had her all of her first shot except for rabies, and she's been treated for fleas and ticks, and she just needs to go to a good home. She's a little bit shy, but once you get her in your arms, she's pretty sweet. She's ready to go.
Well, who would think a beautiful, beautiful dog like this would be at your local dog pound? This is Saber. He's a male husky. Came in this week as a stray, and so far, no owner has come looking for him. He's tested heartworm negative. He's been vaccinated and dewormed. And just to think, if no owner comes forward, someone's going to adopt this dog for $40. Beautiful, beautiful white husky. Who knows if you bought one from a breeder how much it would cost. But we have a lot of beautiful dogs just like this one. And again, he's only $40. What an incredible adoption. He's got a great temperament, great disposition, and will make a great adoption.
This is Millie. She's about 6 months old. She's very playful, very sweet girl. Very talkative. She just needs a good home. There you go. All of her vaccines are included in her adoption.
This is Harley. He's a nice, calm, quiet dog. He's already neutered, so he's ready for a home. Maybe you don't feel like dealing with a puppy that's going to bounce around and chew up the whole house and just want someone that's nice and quiet that you can spend some time with. He's a really sweet dog, just real calm and quiet.
This is Petey. He's a male, about a year old. He's very sweet, just needs a good home. All of his vaccines are included in his adoption.
This is Bo. He's about a five-year-old neutered male, Australian Shepherd mix. This is another one that's already been neutered. He's heartworm negative. He's had his vaccines, deworming, flea treatment. So pretty much with the voucher for rabies shot that's included in the adoption, he has everything he needs for an entire year. So just $40, you get to save a great dog and no other expenses for a whole year. So it's a great place to come and get a dog. And you got him from someone else and had to take him to the vet, that annual visit's going to be anywhere probably between $150 and $300. But he's going to have everything already finished for just $40.
We got a black lab male. He's about a year old. Very energetic. Needs a good home fast. Come on.
Social Circle will be having its 21st annual Friendship Festival on October the 3rd. The festival starts at 9 a.m. and at 9:50 there will be a 5K run. And then at 10 o'clock, the parade through downtown Social Circle. There'll be live music, pony rides, a kids zone, arts and crafts, and you can even win a big green egg smoker. Great food and face painting, and even the local radio station, Q92.3 FM, will be there live broadcasting during the Friendship Festival. So come out to Social Circle on October the 3rd for the 21st annual Friendship Festival. Saturday, October the 10th, is Paws in the Park. It's a 5K run and then a 2K run with dog. The 2K run begins at 8:45, but registration begins at 7:30, so get out there early. And this is a fundraiser to raise funds for the Children's Dog Park. Also on Saturday, October the 10th, is the Monroe Fall Festival from 10 to 4. So after you enjoy some time with your pet at Children's Dog Park, come out to downtown Monroe.